looking pretty.
New South Wales has now officially reached 40% fully vaccinated in terms of our population. That's an incredible milestone to have reached it, given where we were just a few months ago.
A hopeful message as New South Wales grinds into its 11th week of lockdown, and an assurance that what millions are going through now will become a thing of the past.
We certainly won't have to have a statewide lockdown ever again once we hit those 80% double dose vaccination rates, and that's what we're looking forward to.
While these are things to look forward to, the reality is the situation is still going to get worse before it gets better.
All the modelling indicates to us the peak is likely to be here in the next week or two, and then the peak in hospitalisation and intensive care is likely to be with us in October.
Earlier this week, the Premier claimed 5.5% of Delta cases have wound up in hospital, but official figures today show it's actually 11%. Right now, there are 1,030 New South Wales COVID cases in hospitals. 175 of those are in intensive care. The state's total of 855 staffed ICU beds are now 80% full. But the Premier insists the system can cope with the coming surge.
We're keeping a keen eye on the people that have to have intensive care, but we also have great resources in terms of our surge capacity.
In Victoria, despite lower cases, the situation is arguably worse, with more than 90% of ICU beds currently full. With COVID zero now abandoned, Dan Andrews is far from optimistic about shouldering more admissions.
You can have all the machines you want, but machines don't treat patients. People treat patients, and you just run out of them after a while.
So, with daily cases in both states yet to peak, can our health systems cope with what's to come?
Brett Simpson is a delegate of the Australian Paramedics Association and works on the front lines as an intensive care paramedic, and he joins us now. Brett, the New South Wales Premier is sticking to her guns, saying that the system is ready for things to get worse. You're out there responding to calls every day. Does that gel with what you're experiencing?
Look, with all respect to the Premier, no, not really. You know, we've been begging the government for weeks and weeks and weeks, if not months now, that this crisis is coming, and we've been hurtling towards this cliff. And now it's only really taken what people to just be dying in their homes before we can get to them, for them to finally be spurred into action. But, you know, we're just hopeful that whatever they've got planned in the next few weeks is going to be something that ultimately eases some of the pressure on us.
Brett, you guys more than most would get to see how things are running at hospitals. What are you seeing?
Well, unfortunately, at the moment, we're seeing a lot of closed front doors to emergency departments because our staff, literally, we can't get into emergency departments with our patients, whether they be, you know, sick COVID patients or our non-COVID patients, you know, our heart attacks or strokes or trauma patients, you know. Being left outside to care for patients in the freezing rain for, you know, up to 8-9 hours at a time, it's such a struggle. And then to then finally get in and see the pressure that the nursing staff and the medical staff are under, it's unrelenting.
Brett, you just mentioned non-COVID patients. What is the rollover effect from COVID like on all those other things that you would usually get called out to?
People still have their heart attacks, their car accidents, all that type of thing. And anecdotally, we're seeing a lot of people that have put off their healthcare for chronic health conditions because of the lack of resources and fear of going into hospital. So people are much sicker when we get there. They require much more time in hospital. And unfortunately, there's just not capacity for a lot of these people to get the care that they need in time. So we're hoping to see a massive ramp up in hospital capacity in the next few weeks.
Brett, I'm hearing from people inside the public and the private health system at the moment that are genuinely scared about what the next few weeks are going to look like. And yet politicians keep coming out every day and say, actually, no, it's all fine. We've got this. We're going to be able to deal with this. Why is there that mismatch?
Ultimately, the public aren't stupid. They see the images on the news, and when they call 000 and it takes an hour for their ambulance to get there when they've had chest pain, the stark reality hits home for them. I don't know who's advising the Premier or the Health Minister. That's certainly well above my pay grade. But like I said, you've only got to be out on the street or on the front line in an ambulance or in an emergency department to know that the crisis is here. The time for action was months ago. And we can only hope that whatever magical plan or rabbit they're planning to pull out of their hat next week is something that is actually a viable solution that's going to relieve some pressure on paramedics, on nurses and doctors. But I've got to be honest, I'm not particularly hopeful based on what we've seen so far.
Are you scared?
Yeah, absolutely. There isn't a frontline paramedic or healthcare worker out there that doesn't see the strain, hasn't had an experience where they've not been able to get to a patient in time or been able to deliver the care that they want. It's a very real crisis for us. And at the moment, the resources that we've been given to fight this pandemic are effectively trying to take out a rhino with a Nerf gun. It doesn't work. And we really need some genuine action to help steer us out of this crisis.
OK, what genuine action do you need from the Premier?
Well, look, as far as the ambulance service goes, they've employed 30 university graduate paramedics in an ambulance assistant capacity. You know, these are fully graduated university-trained paramedics that, instead of being casual staff with no access to things like sick leave or carers leave, we want to see them as fully fledged trainee paramedics that we can mentor and train up over the next few months, because this is not a crisis that's going to end in 6 or 8 weeks. We anticipate this to be going for months and months and months, especially as we start to open up and we start to see more rates of illness among unvaccinated population.
Brett Simpson, like every frontline worker, we know how precious your time is at the moment and really appreciate you joining us. Thank you.
Thanks so much, guys. Thanks for the time.
Gee, that tells it like it is, doesn't it? Yeah. I mean, obviously the politicians at the moment are trying to paint a picture of optimism, because we need optimism urgently at the moment, but it sounds like unrealistic optimism. I mean, Brett's saying they're taking out a rhino with a Nerf gun.
Of course we all want to hear the good news. We all want to know it is going to get better, but I think when so many people across the different sections of the health sector are saying actually what lies ahead over the next few weeks is really worrying us, it is a bit confusing to see the politicians standing up and assuring us it's going to be fine.
That's why I think it is so key that we do keep spotlighting people like that, because if the Premier is saying that we're going to see it get worse in the next few weeks, well, they're the ones that are going to bear the brunt of it getting worse, you know. They're the ones that are working in this incredibly intense environment. And while we're really wanting the state to open back up, I mean, it's on their shoulders, you know. So, and I'm glad we talked to him this evening.
And patients for 9 hours waiting outside emergency.
Yeah.
That's unacceptable, both for the frontline worker and for the health of the person that's in the ambulance.
Yeah.
Wilco, I also think we've never treated our healthcare workers well enough, particularly in terms of pay. And I think this is the time it's going to really come back to bite us. I know I've got friends that are nurses, and each time they have to go into isolation, some of my friends have now spent, you know, up to 6 weeks on 3 separate occasions of having to isolate for 2 weeks. Each time they do that, they have a cut in their pay, which we already agree as a society is not high enough. And so you'll have a lot of people going, you know what, I can't do this. Mm-hmm. I've got to pay a mortgage, I've got to support a family, and just knowing that the system is not supporting me the way that it expects to be supported in return, why would I keep doing this?
Yeah.
It's hard.
With so much content online, it's sometimes hard to keep up with it all. And let's face it, who has the time? The Project YouTube has you covered with the stories that matter. Hit subscribe for a daily list of the news that you need to know.